Welcome to Season 4 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Josh Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former Commissioner of Health in Baltimore City. Our goal is to bring scientific evidence and experience to current topics in public health through engaging interviews with scientists, community leaders, policy experts, public health officials, clinicians, and more. If you have ideas or questions for us to cover, please email us at publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call. Today, Johns Hopkins vaccine expert Dr. Anna Durbin returns to the program to answer some pressing questions from Stephanie Desmon about COVID-19 vaccines. They discuss booster shots, FDA approval, and why companies keep testing new vaccines, even though we already have some highly effective ones. Let's listen.
Anna Durbin, thanks so much for joining me.
Oh, it's my pleasure.
So I want to talk to you today about vaccines. I have sort of a grab bag of questions about vaccines. First, I want to talk about booster shots. There's been a lot of conversation in recent days and weeks about whether we would need a booster shot. And I guess first, let's explain to people what a booster shot is.
Oh, that's great. Yeah, there has been a lot in the news. And the booster shot is really sort of a nudge to your immune system to say, hey, remember me, gear up, let's make more antibodies, let's be ready in case we see the infection. So a true booster shot is the same vaccine that you got earlier. Generally, it can be months earlier or years earlier. And it's not unusual for vaccines to require a booster shot. We get a tetanus booster shot every 10 years. The question is, for COVID, do we need a booster? And if we need a booster, when will that be? And will that, quote, third shot or booster shot be the same exact vaccine that we got earlier? So these are all of the different questions that are swirling around in the media right now, I would say. And I want to make it, you know, really clear. I think the decision around booster shots won't be made by the pharmaceutical company. The decision around booster shots should be based on data. And, you know, the data to tell us our immune systems are no longer adequately controlling the infection. And I think what we're seeing in data that's being generated in different parts of the world, even around the Delta variant, is that these vaccines are very highly protective against severe COVID, hospitalization, and death due to COVID. And I think the point that I always like to make is that the best way that we can control COVID and control the generation of these new variants and variants of concern is to get as many people in the world vaccinated as possible. So right now, based on the data that we have, to me, it makes far more sense, far greater sense to provide the rest of the world with as many doses of vaccines as we possibly can. The United States right now does not need booster shots. The data do not support booster shots. The CDC is not recommending booster shots. Now, that may change with time. It's not that we may never need a booster shot, but the data right now are telling us that we don't need a booster shot at this time. And I think those doses can be better utilized in other parts of the world.
So I want to ask you also about the FDA. We don't have full approval for the current vaccines we use, Pfizer, Moderna, Johnson & Johnson. They are under emergency use. What do you think the holdup is? And do you think that it will give people more incentive to get the shot once the FDA fully approves them?
Yeah, that is a great question. And I want to clarify by saying, I don't think there is really a holdup. I think the FDA is following their normal process. So for vaccines specifically, the FDA generally requires 6 full months of safety data following the last dose of vaccine. So if you remember, these vaccines were approved in mid to late December. So that means that 6 months following the second dose generally would have occurred in April, May of this year, possibly June. The company has to acquire all of that safety data. And they also have to look at the data that has been generated post emergency use authorization. So not just in people who received the vaccine as part of a clinical trial, they're going to evaluate reports to the vaccine adverse event reporting system, adverse events that have come in to those companies, their safety monitoring from people who have received the vaccine under emergency use authorization. They have to acquire a lot of data from that safety data and make sure that it is a complete data set and that they've gone through it and they've extracted any questions, queries, concerns that they think the FDA should address. And the FDA will then go through those data and see if they have questions, require more information, that sort of thing. I think the other thing that's important to note is that the FDA, in part of their full approval, looks not only at safety and efficacy data, but also looks at manufacturing. So can this company produce the same vaccine over and over and over again to ensure that the quality of production is there? So the companies have to produce generally at least three different lots of vaccine and show that the potency of the vaccine, the quality of the vaccine is consistent from lot to lot to lot. And that gives the consumer the assurance that any product, any vaccine that they get is going to be potent, is going to be safe, is going to be effective. And I think if they went too quickly and didn't go through that process and really evaluate all the data, then the criticism would be you rushed it through. You know, the fact of the matter is people can get vaccine if they want to get vaccinated. They're able to get vaccinated. The full approval, waiting for full approval is not preventing people from vaccination. It is true some people will feel more comfortable with vaccination. But I think a good discussion between individuals and their physicians, shared decision-making, could alleviate some of those concerns. We have given these vaccines to hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of millions of people. The safety data are there. People should feel comfortable taking these vaccines. But I do think it's important that the FDA follow their process and not shorten it, because down the line, I think that could ensue criticism. And some people would say, well, look, they were rushed to approve. They didn't use their full process. So I'm not going to take the vaccine because it didn't go through the full approval process. I think we'll have approval, hopefully in the fall sometime, definitely by the end of the year. And people can take the vaccine with extreme confidence. I think people can take the vaccine with confidence now. But I think if they're waiting for that full approval, it's important that that process be followed.
I also keep hearing that there are new vaccines being tested. I thought we had some great vaccines. So what is the story there? I saw that a company called Novavax had a 90% effectiveness rate. I saw another one that actually was very weak and probably will not be approved. So I'm curious why at this point, when we have these great vaccines, are we trying to make more different ones?
Yeah, so I think that's a great point. I mean, one, the major reason is we still don't have enough vaccine to vaccinate the world. So we need more doses out there. And we can't keep up with demand right now in terms of the production of the mRNA vaccines, the adenovirus vectored vaccine, J&J, AstraZeneca, Moderna, Pfizer. We don't have enough doses. We need more. And so if we can supplement the market with different effective vaccines, I think that will be important. The other issue is that there are some vaccines people may not feel comfortable taking an mRNA vaccine. The Novavax vaccine uses a technology that's more similar to previous vaccines. So people may be more comfortable with that type of technology. But I really think the more product that we have that are safe and effective, the faster we're going to get the world vaccinated. We can increase the supply and get more people vaccinated. I think as more products come onto the market, you'll see other products sort of go away. So I would not be surprised, for instance, that some of the less effective vaccines, for instance, the killed or inactivated vaccines that are currently made in China, they may be supplemented by vaccines like the Novavax vaccine or other mRNA vaccines that come onto the market. Because if they're more effective, they'll probably be used more widely. But right now, my advice to people around the world is if you have a vaccine available to you, please, please take it. Even if it may be somewhat less effective, even the inactivated vaccines have shown pretty good efficacy against severe COVID and death. And it certainly is better to receive an inactivated or a killed vaccine than it is to receive no vaccine. But as more products, as more vaccines come onto the market, we'll be able to vaccinate more people. And we may be able to, as I said, replace less effective vaccines with those that are more effective.
And I understand that the Novavax is essentially made the same way as like a hepatitis B vaccine. So it's something that we're used to, right?
Exactly. And people may feel more comfortable with that. Exactly right.
Anna Durbin, thank you so much for joining me.
Oh, you're welcome. It's always a pleasure.
Public Health On Call is produced by Josh Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by Spencer Greer, Niall Owen McCusker, C.N. Oates, and Matthew Martin, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo and Neiman Outland. Social media support from Brenda Hageter, Grace Holz Fernandez, and Caroline Wong. Thank you for listening.